start right away. Good evening, guys, and thank you for making it at 7 here after office hours. And we'll jump into the topic right away. We'll discuss about hosting a Blazor app using Azure Static Storage websites. So basically, we have two new concepts and two new ways of developing SPS, single page applications, and deploying them. How many web developers here? Okay. And the web developers starting from the ASPX days, web forms ASPX days. And what would be the one thing, you know, which we as web developers, we always wanted to see in our Microsoft applications development? Let's make this interactive. You know, I'll gabbing on all along and you guys just staring at the screen doesn't make sense. So yeah, so you know that one thing which we always wanted to speed up our development, or one wish, you know, as a web developer, what was that one thing which you always wished would come in the next release, something like that? Any wishes for web devs? Okay, fine. So, you know, as a web dev, I wish that I wouldn't have to write so much of JavaScript code. Then I wish that I wouldn't have to learn Razor syntax when they came up with MVC. After that, I wished I didn't have to learn AngularJS, which I had to. And then going forward, the next year they came with Angular 2, and suddenly you're like, this is changed. So yeah, so now another thing was, all of us, we wish that we should know only one language, and that should be able to help us to get through client-side and server-side coding. So well, wish granted, they have come up with Blazor. So as you see, that's similar to Razor. So the syntax which you see would be similar to the Razor syntax. But what Blazor essentially does is, your DLLs, the server-side code, you can render in client-side browser. Okay, so it runs on top of WebAssembly, which is a W3C standard. So it's not something, you know, they have introduced out of the blue. Okay, second thing is, most of us, when we want to develop websites, content, web content, not all of that is dynamic. Most of the times we just want to develop sites with our blogs, which is static content. And then doing so on Azure, you know, which are some shared hosting sites, incurs a substantial amount of cost. So yeah, so for Azure Static Storage, the primary motivation is that organizations and individuals, we need to deploy static websites frequently, blog content or just about us, contact us kind of company websites. And then we are always on the path of improving the time to deploy, improving the cost viability. And traditional shared hosting providers cost somewhere around $8 to $10 per month. These are still a bit, you know, a conservative measures. Could be more, taken from the website about 2 years ago. Okay, so just on the conservative side. Okay, and why do shared hosting require these costs? Because we need to reserve some CPU and VM memory. Okay. But what if our content is not dynamic, it's just static, you know? You don't really require some server-side I/O and stuff. All you require is storage and bandwidth. So that is where Azure Static Storage comes into play. They have very recently, maybe around 1.5 years back, this announcement was made. And as we go along, we'll see, you know, how not to confuse it with Azure Block Storage and what are the benefits we get with static storage. Okay, so yeah, they announced static website hosting, which was yet another option. So you have many other options already available. That is your traditional deployment using the app service. Then you have Kubernetes, Docker, VMs, and all those things. Okay, so we'll see the power of hosting on Azure Static Storage. The metrics which will form the basis of our comparison of deciding why static storage for single page applications, and essentially it's only for, you know, static content which, you know, won't change frequently. It wouldn't require you to write APIs and server side connection and all. Static content which you may just update frequently, but this is just HTML rendered application. So the metrics for our comparison would be how much effort to manually deploy an application with the traditional method vis-a-vis our Azure Static Storage websites. configuration which is needed, how much does it scale, how much does it perform, and how much does it cost. So while the first three, you know, it depends on what are you using. Are you using Visual Team, VSTS, Visual Team Studio to deploy? Are you copying the scripts manually, writing some scripts to upload your published folder to the cloud and all those things? The major point of contention would be the last two metrics. How does it perform? What does it cost? Okay, straight away, this is the data taken from the blog site, which was introduced when they introduced static storage. So if you look at app service, when we are deploying using app service, it's just the straightforward calculation is one instance with the minimum configuration, it is still going to cost you around 60 euros per month. Okay, the second method of popular method of deploying would be using Azure Function app plus the storage. Okay, so these are some of the assumptions you see that our single page application consists of, maybe it's not a very big application, so five files, maybe home, about, contact us, careers, and sort of those stuff, with about 100,000 requests per day for 1 month, which makes about 15 million requests per month. Okay, the calculations based on that would be, just for the traffic would be 0.7 euro per month, and then the storage cost would be around 5.6, which comes to 5.81. That you trade off with the static storage. Static storage, how it is priced is, you are hosting it at no cost. The only cost for static storage comes in for your blob storage and the operations which are performed. So which means you are paying only for the storage and operations, which comes to 4.64 euro per month, assuming we are not a very big website and we require, I mean, the number of requests is not exponentially big. So which means we have a clear winner there. Azure Static Storage is very cost effective. And when you perform, when you compare the storage performance, when you compare the performance with 10,000 requests across all three applications, there also you see that the storage is the clear winner. One baffling fact is why Azure Function with app would take so much time. But yeah, I mean, when you try and run, this is actually the responses which you get for about 1,000, 10,000, and 100,000 requests. Any case, our purpose is solved. Azure Static Storage performs the best even here. Okay, now let's diverge a bit. How to leverage on Azure Static Storage and how to empower that with the Blazor application. Before we move on to the final demo, where we see how to publish Blazor app and upload it on the static storage website, first let us dive into the details of Blazor. So as I have been saying, you know, Blazor is a framework which enables us to compile our DLL server-side code and render them into the browser. So it was basically, it is still in the preview version. So if you download Visual Studio 2019, how many of you are already using Visual Studio 2019? Okay, so in the Visual Studio 2019, I think the latest update is 16.3. I'm not sure. It doesn't ship with that. This is still in the preview version, the Blazor. Okay, and so basically with 2019, what you see is, it hasn't been a better time to be a .NET developer. You can build a myriad of apps across myriad platforms with different technologies, communicating with each other over diverse platforms. So it comes in .NET Core 3.0 is introduced, and the preview 6 version will include the Blazor templates. Okay. And of course, as you have been seeing that with each release of Visual Studio IDE, they are extending the support more and more towards diverse applications. How many of you have been using Visual Studio 2017 to develop .NET Core apps? Yeah, so in Visual Studio 2017, when you see that you are trying to have a console app, .NET console app, or WPF doesn't come with the .NET Core support. Web app, you have an option. You want to, the template, the project, the type of project you choose, you get that option, ASP.NET Core, whatever. Then you choose the versions 2.0, 1.1, whatever. But you don't see it for web, WPF, WinForms, etc. With 2019, you have that capacity. So that is just a bit Okay. Now, what do we do with .NET Core 3.0? So, of course, it has the ASP.NET Core functionality intact with MVC, Razor Pages, Web API, SignalR, with some improvements to security and identity. Okay. The component which they have introduced, Blazor, this would be writing the client side. Also, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't mean that you cannot write your JavaScript code anymore, or you're not able to allow to leverage on your React and Angular code. Yeah, you can of course do that. On top of that, you can build components only with C# code. And you have something called as gRPC services. Those are background worker services used for communication between processes or applications. Okay, so if time permits, at the end we will see this demo where we see all the three parts we have discussed: the client, the Blazor front end, the gRPC services, and the ASP.NET Core working in tandem and bringing us this application. Okay, so what does a full stack application entail? Okay, the client side would be, the UI which you saw that. So the client side would be just a grid which is accepting certain orders for processing. Though this is not real-time processing. You just enter the order, the status you would see here would be pending. Then, so that would be, the client side would be built using Blazor. Then we would have a background worker process running based on, built on using gRPC. How many of you are aware of the gRPC protocol? Okay, yeah. So I would mention a bit of that when we are actually seeing the demo, gRPC. And so gRPC protocol, the worker services is built on that, and it runs in the background. As soon as an order is received, it will process the order, and then it will communicate the status back to the UI. And that is done using, the communication is done by using SignalR. Okay. So Blazor basically is built client-side web UI with .NET instead of JavaScript. Call into the JavaScript libraries and browser APIs as needed if you have already existing JavaScript libraries. You can write web UI components, reusable components, and share the .NET code with both client and server. How many of us are working with Angular? Angular JS, Angular 2, Angular 4? Okay, so in Angular, we see that we have reusable components, right? I mean, once you have a component, you can use it across pages. So same thing, same concept is there with Blazor also. So once you build a component, you can use it in various other pages as well. So each page, like for example, to relate it to the ASPX days, ASPX, if you had to have if you had to have some common controls, then you used to have those master child pages or user controls in which the control is shared across pages. So it's a extension of that concept, but in a more user-friendly way. Okay. So Blazor for WebAssembly is now in the official preview. Again, when you get the version of Visual Studio 2019, you get the Blazor server-side template. You don't get the Blazor client-side template per se unless you are working with the preview version. Okay, so this is what I was talking about. So you have two templates, Blazor on client-side or server-side. Blazor on client-side is running completely on the browser thanks to the WebAssembly, and which is your C# Razor code, both are rendered in the browser. Okay. And for the Blazor server side, they are rendered to the browser using SignalR. So basically everything is compiled on the server side for Blazor server side templates, and that code is rendered to the client side using SignalR protocol. There are pros and cons of both approach. We'll see them shortly. So in the demo for Blazor, we will see the components of Blazor built using Blazor client-side template, and I'll walk you through the reusable components and how the file looks and how the DLLs are compiled and available as a JS.js. So we'll jump into the demo. Okay, first of all, I would like to show you how the templates look for Okay, so if I click on create a new project here. Okay, let's go for a .NET Core web application. Click next. Yeah, any name, it's okay. Okay, and when I click on create, you would get an option for the to choose the templates for using which you would want to go and build. So you see here, worker service, web app, Blazor server side, and Blazor client side. So we have constructed our demo using Blazor client side. Okay, let's just close it because we already have created it. Okay, yeah, so once you create your Blazor application using the client side template, these are the three default projects you get: Blazor sample client, Blazor sample server, Blazor sample shared. Shared is a project which is some shared classes between the client and server. Have a keen look at the client project. These are your pages, okay? These are Razor pages, or essentially your ASPX or HTML pages, the UI. You have components here, so imports.razor, counter razor, fetch data razor, index razor. Also, please pay attention to the fact that you don't have a folder called as scripts or content anywhere which is having your JavaScript libraries. It's purely if you go inside the code here, counter.razor or fetch data razor, index razor, it's all C# code. You don't see any JavaScript libraries being included or whatever. I mean, forget the styling, CSS and stuff, Bootstrap and all. But apart from that, for any of the functionality, you don't see any. So this syntax, if you see, would remind you much of the Razor syntax we used with MVC. It's very close to that, but it's all using C# code. You don't see any client-side libraries anywhere. Okay, and these are the program and startup, which if you have worked with .NET Core, we are very familiar with how they are used to build the configuration and set up the ports and everything. Okay, Blazor sample server, if you see, it will have your normal controllers and everything from where they are calling, you know, the APIs to render the data. Let's quickly run and see. Okay, this Blazor Grid component, I will give you the link later on, which all these demos are available on GitHub. So it's a component built and we have imported it. It is just to highlight the capabilities of using Blazor, powerful Blazor components, rather than using the built-in THTD tags and rendering the grid as a table. Okay. So this Blazor Grid, there are many third-party components already built and available in Blazor, and you can already start importing them for your application. Okay, let's run this Blazor sample and let us see how it is, it looks in the Internet Explorer. Does it bother any of us that, you know, our DLLs are now being rendered on the browser? I mean, last time when I was talking in the Dev Insider about Blazor, a lot of people came up and asked me this, you know, that your DLLs, I mean, that's a server-side code, right? What if I can hack into it? And that is something which is now being made available to me on my browser. Does it compromise my security? Does it compromise my application in any way? No. Because this is not something they have introduced out of the box. WebAssembly is a W3C standard. It's a standard, so the framework is tuned to that standard. So it doesn't in any way compromise our code, or it doesn't, for example, something which the database calls, for example, won't be rendered in the client side. So whatever paradigms or whatever rules are applying to our normal applications, the same apply here. There's no compromise security or anything like that. Okay, so let us look at our, we do a quick F12. And let us again reload. Okay, now you see this mono.js, right? You see, and you see our DLLs also in the browser. And thanks to this mono.js that is responsible for converting our client-side code, making it available and rendered in the client-side in the browser. Okay, then you can also see all your DLLs. I suppose anyone who has debugged our previous applications, Angular or whatever, with Firebug or Postman or stuff like that, I'm pretty sure we are not able to see these DLLs like this rendered in the client side. It's very much available here. You can see that. And the extra file which we see here is the mono.js and mono.wsm. This WSM file is the WebAssembly file. The WebAssembly file, which is the protocol that WebAssembly W3C standard, which allows the server-side libraries also to be rendered in the browser. Coming back to, so this is a very simple, default template you get once you create a Blazor client-side application. About reusability. So this was a separate page altogether. There are three pages: home, counter, fetch data. So counter was a separate page, razor page altogether, if you see in our application here. Yeah, if you see in our application here, in the pages, you had index, fetch data, counter. So counter was a separate razor page. I can always use it here in this page. It will give IntelliSense also if you want to use it. Okay, yeah. So you can use it as a tag. Same thing what we do with Angular. You build components, you import them in other pages. So much the same way you can also do this. So essentially, since this code was already there, what I've done is this counter page, I've imported that component in the home page. I click, it increments the counter. So basically, the functionality doesn't change. It's just to show you that we are building reusable components. The razor pages can be used across the application pages. Okay. Now, let's move on. Yeah. Yeah. So that was a Blazor on client. Okay, I will quickly, in 5 minutes, I'll show you Blazor on server side. That is a much complex thing with all the gRPC and server side coding and all. Let me see how much we can cover. We started off quite late. Okay, yeah. So this is our Blazor template, Blazor application built with the server side. And you see that this has three things: application, shared is the shared libraries between client server, and the worker process. The worker process, it works on a gRPC protocol. So gRPC protocol is a protocol which was introduced by Google few years ago. And if I were to believe industry insiders, it is now going to very quickly replace our normal REST API calls, okay? Because what happens with gRPC is that you have a definitive contract on the functions which are written. And plus, what do you think gRPC, you have used gRPC, right? What do you think, because I was asked this question and I have faced this myself, this difficulty, that when you work with REST API, so when I was explaining gRPC services, people came to me saying that you already have REST. It's a very popular paradigm. It's microservices are built already. Huge frameworks are there. So why gRPC? And why it is such a big deal now? So what do you think in your experience that gRPC brings in what REST does not?
For me, it's the enforcement of the protobufs, like being able to define all your types.
Correct.
And the contracts, as you mentioned. Right. That's like the strongest point.
Yeah. Another point for me was dual streaming. REST doesn't allow that at all. Like, even if you were to enforce that, there's no streaming in REST. And that is something which is very beautifully handled by gRPC. So gRPC, it enforces a protocol on you, a protocol on the server and client. So it's like a contract they agree on, and that is how I'm going to write my function. This is how I'm going to consume my function, something like that. And it's RPC, it's a remote procedure call, but on based on certain contracts. So if you look at this is the protobuf file, which is the building block of a gRPC. Okay, so this file, this is the contract which I'm talking about. So this is like a pre-agreed syntax. So once this syntax is shared between client and server, they know that there will be a service called as orders manager. There is going to be a message sent from the server for order request, and the client is going to get back a reply in the form of order reply, something like that. It's pre-agreed upon. And if you look here also, the proto file is shared. See, protos. The proto file is shared between the client and the server. Okay. So quickly, if we run this application now, it takes a bit of time to run because on my laptop, as you see, I have right from Visual Studio 2008. So right from the ASPX days to the Blazor days. Okay. Yep. Okay. So let's say donuts, for example, maybe quantity 20. Okay. Save order. So this is not immediately processed. An order is entered. Okay. It is there in the pipeline, in the queue, and it's pending. Now let us run the worker process, which we have where the protocol is defined using the protobuf file. Let's run that. The worker is built using the gRPC as a client. Okay. See, order with ID 4 has been processed, right? And now if I just refresh my page here, it will immediately notify that this order has been processed now. It's no longer waiting in queue, right? So this communication from the client server back and forth, worker services running in background, long running services, that has been addressed. And another advantage of using worker services with Blazor framework is, let's say today this is hosted, the worker was hosted using a Windows service. Tomorrow you may want to use Event Viewer to log everything. That also can be done by adding just few lines of code and some packages, a NuGet packages. But it knows that when it's rendered as a Windows service, I should log the output in console. When it is as a Event Viewer, then where I should log and all those are inbuilt into the framework, and it's very intuitive coding. You don't have to put in a lot of effort or stuff to do that. Okay, moving on. So that was about Blazor. So we saw two concepts. One is Blazor, one is why Azure Static Storage. Now let's quickly combine those two and see the power of deploying Blazor on Azure Static Storage. Okay. So how many of you have a free Azure subscription? You know, you can just log into the portal and check out all the features offerings of Azure. Okay, if you ask a question, you might get one today. So for deployment, we will first log in to our Azure portal, and there you will see something like this. Yeah. So I have logged in to my Azure portal. In there, you go to storage accounts. Okay, go to storage accounts, and then you click on add storage account. Okay, add here. Basically give whatever your subscription is. Resource group is the name what you want to give to your resource or account. Has to be a unique name. If this is repeated, it won't allow you to create. It will give you a validation error when you are trying to review and recreate here. Storage account name, location, and rest all the things you can leave it as general. It is already a storage V2 general purpose account. It's different from the Azure Blob storage. Okay. When you create, review, and create, it will create your storage account with the defaults. So I have already created one which is called as Blazor Static Storage. Now, if you go to this Blazor Static Storage, there most of the things are already configured for us. We need to go to the static website prompt, okay? And there, initially you will see that it is in a disabled state. You just make it enabled and it will give you two endpoints, primary and secondary. It generates on its own. Just keep an eye on the format of that. It gives HTTPS and the name of the account you have given, and then these are generated by Azure. Okay, so when we are publishing or uploading our files to this static storage website, just keep be mindful of the account name you have given it. You will have to give that in the syntax. Okay, so, and if you see that it creates a dollar web folder here, if you go to this web folder, yeah, if you initially when you create that, it would be in a private access. You change it to either blob or container, both of which will allow you to browse the website once it is hosted. Okay, so I've made it a blob access. And if you look at the contents of this, this is what we have published from our Blazor app. Okay, we'll discuss that how we have done that. So let's go to our Blazor app here. The first one which we saw with the, yeah, no, sorry, Blazor sample, yeah, this one, yeah. And I basically just published the application. When you publish the application, it will, yeah, okay. When you publish the application, it will just, if I open it in the Explorer, File Explorer, yeah. Once you publish the application, it will create, yeah, these are the published files it has created, which we have to upload to our dollar web folder on the Azure Static Storage. So for that, you have multiple ways to upload the files. You can use Visual Studio Code interface and you have a upload button there to upload, or you can use the interface provided on the Azure portal itself where you can upload files. So if I go here, yeah, here, upload. You can upload files from here also, but that is a bit tedious. Okay, you have to do it file by file. Or you have Azure CLI command prompt from where you can run commands and upload the entire folder or files inside that folder to the dollar web folder. So this is what I have done. So this is our Azure CLI. I downloaded it. And then these are the commands. AZ storage blob update. You have to give this account name and then the account name of your account which you have specified, which in our case is Blazor Static Storage. Whatever the account name you have given when you're creating your static websites. Okay, so you do that account name and the files you want to upload, the folders you want to upload. Once that is done, this is how it looks like. Okay, so this is your dollar web folder. Yeah. And these are the files you have uploaded. One thing to notice here is when you are creating your static website, it will ask you for two things, your default page and your not found 404 page. So those you have to specify. For the 404, which is not found page, you can give the same index.html so that it falls back. Because if you don't have a, you know, error page configured, you can give the same fallback page so that you don't get that ugly Azure cannot find XML error. So go back to your website, go back to the static website. There are other options you can see, blobs, custom domain. Custom domain is if what if you don't want to use this default link which is given here, but you may want to have some custom domain configured, you can do that here. Okay, access keys, replication, cross domain policy and stuff. So now all our basic stuff is done. If you look that, if you look here, I have configured the default name, the landing page and the error page. And if you just browse this, is it already there? With the primary or the secondary endpoint, both of them could be there. Yeah. So we are just browsing it. and yeah, your application is rendered. Takes a bit of time. But this, again, you know, the static storage, as I kept on highlighting, is only for static data. To reiterate, when you will try to go to the fetch data page is actually fetching some data from API of server side. That won't work here. So now this same application is working hosted on a static Azure website. You look at the counter field, the counter page, the home page, both of them work as expected. The counter also, so because this is static data, as soon as I'm navigating to the fetch data page, it will throw an error. You can look at the network here. Yeah, see, console error, because it is trying to look for a server call here, weather forecast, API sample data, which is a server request to fetch some remote data. So how to do that, how to configure and how to have Azure functions set up to communicate with your server side will be covered in the future sessions. So that's all for now. So we see how, you know, easy it is to deploy SPAs built with Blazor to Azure Static Storage. And I would be happy to take any questions.